hesitate to ask or add any comments here. But before we start, we would like to wake you up after the lunch break, and we are very curious to know your opinion about the following statement. Nina, if you could please go to the next slide. So 5 years from now, how many students can organize their mobility without paper or PDF? So what do you think? While I am starting the poll and I ask everybody to vote, I will briefly introduce what we'll expect you during the next 30 minutes. First of all, we want to set the scene and explain what we mean by barriers for student mobility. Second, we would like to highlight the chances and challenges in transforming higher education processes through digital services. Third, we briefly introduced the two projects, Live Sciences and PIM, and with, of course, a live demo, we would like to demonstrate the digital services provided by PIM and sketch the way from PIM, from a project towards a product. And at the end, we are happy to discuss potentials and limitations of these services to actually break down barriers for student mobility together with you. Okay, thanks for voting, everybody. Most of you think that at least, or that, that many of you think that the majority of students will be able to organize their mobility without papers and PDF within 5 years or after 5 years. And yeah, what possible barriers can we actually address by implementing new or enhanced digital services? So by kind of also eliminating papers and PDFs. At the next slide, we try to kind of sketch what we mean by barriers. And as you may know, of course, students face many, many barriers on their student journey. During orientation, students have to make choices on courses or identify courses which can be recognized at the home institutions or within their study programs if they decide to go abroad, either virtually or on campus. During the mobility, usually many changes or have to be made and lots of paperwork. Students have to face lots of paperwork in, changing learning agreements or mobility agreements. And after they return back to their home institutions, they have to struggle with getting their achievements recognized towards their study program and accounted towards their final degrees. So with digitalization, we actually have the chances to not only translate administrative processes towards into the digital world, we have the ability to actually enhance processes and these challenges or these which challenges we face will be part of the next slides.
Yeah, hello also from me. I'm Wolfgang Radenbach, working also in Göttingen. And as Anna told us, as we all know, this transformation of higher educational processes is a big challenge for many universities. And of course, in this 30 minutes, we cannot solve all these challenges. We might not even solve one of it, but we will start with a single step in this in the mobility process, namely, a person is returning from a semester abroad. So we have Nina as a student who usually studies in Göttingen but went to Sweden. And now she comes back and, of course, she would like to transfer their results, her results. And in an analog way, or semi-digital way, she would might get a PDF, which she takes home and then goes to an examination office. And this we can do better with digital services. Namely, you can transfer this data digitally and also start a workflow at her home institution that makes it easy for her and also for her lecturers to accept the transfer credits. So this is one barrier in this mobility journey we might overcome. And why is it good that, and now from a student perspective, that I transfer my achievements digitally? And the first one, it's not, maybe not an obvious one, but it's a very important one from our point of view, that namely that these are my data. I should decide which examination results will be transferred after having been abroad. So self-sovereign identity is a very important issue. Then there are other things that make the work easier with digital tools. For instance, I can have a recognition history, what has been already accepted before. That makes it easier for me when deciding which courses I take, and also for my tutors and my lecturers who can rely on this database. With digital processes, I can make a workflow more transparent. For instance, if you think of ordering at Amazon, it's very clear at which step the process is at the moment, usually at least. You get emails and things like this, status page, and this we can do the same also for recognition processes. And last one, which is maybe not obvious at first, but usually it's not that you write an exam on your last day of your stay and then you come home, but the result is not yet there already. So with digital services, you can start the process of recognition and transferring data even when you have returned home. So many reasons why we should think about transferring a process like this digital. And we will see later on that doing this also helps other processes being easier. Something which is not so important from a student point of view, but from a higher education institution point of view, that there are also legal requirements that we are supposed to digitalize this process. But for us, more important that we help students and teachers ease these processes. And how we did this, this will be the next part of our talk. So we will shortly introduce you the two, these are projects, but it's ongoing work. So it's, from my point of view, more than projects, namely Life Science or Live Science and PIM. And I will start with introducing PIM. PIM is a digital platform, work in progress, that aim is to connect two worlds, namely on the right side, the world at one's university, local student information system, local administrative processes, and the outer world, to say, so the world that is dominated by other student information systems, by EU standard and initiatives to standardize these processes. Something is very dynamic processes and something which as a university we don't have in full control. And what the aim of PIM is to connect these two worlds by providing a workflow and digital interfaces. We will see it later on in the live demo, so that each individual university does not have to connect to all to these services by themselves. Such a recognition process is not only present when returning from abroad. It's something you have also in other situations at the university. For instance, if you change your university, or if you, so inside the country, or if you start your mobility, usually you should also think about recognition beforehand so that you know which modules you can take. And the aim of PIM is to cover all these recognition processes. So I would like, this is PIM, and now I'd like to hand over to Anna, who will include it in the context of Live Sciences.
Yes, thanks, Wolfgang. With Live Sciences, we aim to address or facilitate the whole student international journey. And as you can see in the next slide, these digital services which are provided by PIM and others do not only address like facilitate, for instance, data transfer of students or study achievements. They also have implementations on the overall student journey because they can influence the subject choice students have to take during the orientation already of the student international journey. And we also aim to implement these processes sustainable. So the development to also align the processes or the implementations of digital services aligned to the developments which take place in the development of international curricula and study programs. So with the Life Sciences project, we would like to align these processes to make sure that the new developments are recognized also by the implementations of digital services. And thereby, we aim to strengthen international cooperation and student mobility and improve the functionalities and the benefits with our European and non-European partner and partner universities. Yes. And I think with the next live demo, you will get a clearer picture of what are the services which are actually provided by PIM.
Yeah, I'm happy to show you the new core functionalities of PIM. To this end, I'm Nina Warnknecht, also team member of the team in Göttingen. And before we have a look on the platform itself, I would like to have a look on two problems we want to solve, or we not solve but address in the scenario in the live demo. The first is if we imagine I'm a student and I'm planning my mobility in Sweden, and I would like to take a class on a module. This is called Digital Transformation in Regional Businesses in Sweden. But I wonder if there's a equivalent module in Göttingen or not. I'm not sure. So this is the first problem we will have a look at in the live demo. So please keep it in mind. And the second one is, so this is the first part, let's say, of mobility. And the second problem, assigned to the this return phase, which Wolfgang also mentioned in the beginning of this presentation. So now I was in Sweden and I passed modules in at the partner university. I want to recognize them after this day. I welcome you, want to welcome you on the platform. Therefore, I have to close the presentation and share my screen. So don't wonder. Okay. In my browser, it looks as if you could see my screen. This is okay, probably.
Yeah, that's better.
Yeah, perfect. Then welcome to PIM. I'm logged in as a student. I have the possibility here to check if I'm assigned to my study program. And yes, I am. This is great. So at first step, I want to try to manage my first problem. And I therefore, I click on the recognition history. And I'm searching for the external university here. It's in Sweden. It's this partner university. And I, okay. So this is the module I would like to do in Sweden. And if I just click on this button, I can see, okay, it was already recognized at my university in Göttingen, and this decision was accepted. Okay, so that's not, of course, not a guarantee, but it makes me so hopeful that it worked for me, that it will work for me too. Now I have to start the pre-recognition. via this. And we have to select Sweden now and the university. Okay, here it's possible to add the time span of the mobility. Okay, so my study program is assigned. Okay, that's great. I can see it here. And now I want to add the module. Okay, yeah, so this is, of course, prepared, but I have to add the information here. And if I come to the to this fields which are required, and the database recognized the module ID, which I typed in before, then it suggested me to override the module with the one from the database, and that's good because then that's definitely the same module which was already recognized in the database, and I have to add the module description here. So this is it's possible for me to link my module description so I don't have to upload in PDF. Okay, I want to choose the same module, business informatics, as the one before. Okay, here I can see external points are 6 credit points and internal also 6. So from my perspective, that looks okay. And now I can hand in the proposal. I can, in this summary, I can see all my information, which I typed in, and I can just send it now. And maybe you remember that this was this recognition history was empty before, and now it's possible here to see the new proposal and the status that it's in formal reviewing. Okay, my second problem is that I want to, if we remember, the second problem we wanted to address is the recognition afterwards. To this end, I have to start the recognition afterwards and to choose this national contact point. It's a test contact point in this case, and start the import. And now I leave PIM and welcome to Sweden here. I have to log in with my data there, choose my university, and now let's see if MREX can help me. Okay, I want to transfer this to this program and this module, and okay, that looks good to me. Okay, we're back at PIM and the results are transferred. I can go further and the information is already exported to PIM. It's possible here, for example, to group the models, but in this case, it's okay for me to have two parts, let's say. Here I got the information that I have missing data. I have to add it because otherwise the application cannot be finished. Okay, so for this first program, I want to recognize a study area. And the second module I would like to recognize as a module 2. Okay. Yeah, the next steps are similar to the one before, and the credits for this study area will be added by the reviewer, and it's not important for me here because the reviewer will add it in the reviewing process. Okay, I can hand it in and see here that all in formal reviewing, and if they're accepted, it's also shown here. Yeah, then this has changed to accepted. Okay, then I will come back to you and we will come back to our presentation slide and to the last part and to our Outlook.
Okay, so as you have seen, it's already possible to transfer data electronically, digitally, and start a recognition workflow from the status of PIM. This is something which is developed right now, and we start using it at two pilot universities at the moment. And so, no, you cannot start now if you like to use it at your university, but I will in a minute show what you can do now if you are interested. But maybe you think also, maybe you're not from Germany or think, okay, this is a nice idea to build such a platform, then of course from a project to a product might also that you think, okay, this is something you will build in France or Croatia or whatever you are from. And we are happy to share our experiences. From a PIM point of view, what we are planning to do in the next 2 years is decreasing the project character of PIM and starting it as a product. So product in the sense of you can actually use it for real life cases. And if you look at our graphic on our roadmap, that we will at the moment start with pilot universities, and next year, so mid of next year, US university can also start using PIM. And if you think about this, it's, as you know, universities or higher education institutions usually it takes time to change something. So what you should do now is think about your processes on think about this idea, and also think about how your data is and how your university, is it something which has the same recognition process in the whole university? Probably not. But is there a process at all? This is something you would need to use such a digital system. So I hope we could give you some insight what is possible with a platform like PIM. And now I will give back to Nina and Anna for a final discussion.
Yeah, actually, we would like to ask again or get refresh your mind after the presentation and ask again, what do you think in 5 years from now, how many students can organize their mobility without a paper or PDF? And we would like to start the poll again and ask you to vote once more. What do you think after listening to the presentation? Okay, now I have to kind of check whether we have changed your mind. Still one person thinks that 100% going to organize the mobility without paper or PDF. 80% we had 6 and there are 10. Okay, less people now who think that the majority, and 60%. Let's check. Okay, since a few people also left, I guess the overall picture is the same. Many of you are probably involved in higher education processes. And therefore, we are really curious also to get your opinion on whether transparency in higher education processes further will encourage international student mobility. And please use the chat to share your opinion or raise your hand to if you would like to add something to the discussion. And maybe if you do so, you could give or share some little information about your background. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Yeah. Maybe in the meantime, Wolfgang could also give some insights into how PIM will kind of tackle transparency.
And by transparency, we mean, for instance, things like a recognition history, so that you can publicly see which modules have been recognized before for other students, which might be a good thing for students, but maybe it also prevents, or maybe some teachers won't like it because such a recognition might be very depending on the student. And okay, there's also another question, how to interact your cooperate with the EVP developments. It is, if you look here on this side, on the left side, PIM will connect, or is we are in the process of on connecting to Mobility Online and Move On. So we will not directly connect at the moment, at least to the, for instance, EVP EWP dashboard. But what we will do is we will connect to Mobility Online and Move On, since these are the other softwares that are used by international offices, and they have interfaces to EWP. So this will be the data transfer with EWP.
Yes, during the project work, we have recognized that actually the uncertainty of the recognition of modules after returning from an exchange semester is one of the biggest limitations to student mobility, to international student mobility. Therefore, we aim to use the transform to transform the digital service to kind of add transparency to the whole recognition processes and make use of the opportunities. Any final statement, just comment otherwise? Nina, would you like to add something on the...
Okay, there's a question on the online user, online learning came in, and yes, indeed, if the student has finished his pre-recognition, then, for instance, Move On will take this data and fill out the learning agreement. So this is, pre-recognition is exactly what you need for filling out the learning agreement, and so you don't have to enter it again. Move On will take this data and then fill out the learning agreement. And yeah, I think we can switch to the first slide for the, we can enter it here.
Yeah, thank you for listening and thank you for taking part in this session. And I guess we meet again in one of the other very interesting and exciting sessions within the next 2 days.